A reading from the beginning of the book of Revelation. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants what must happen soon. He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John, who gives witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ by reporting what he saw. Blessed is the one who reads aloud, and blessed are those who listen to this prophetic message and heed what is written in it, for the appointed time is near. John, to the seven churches in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne. I heard the Lord saying to me, to the angel of the church in Ephesus, write this. The one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks in the midst of the seven gold lampstands says this. I know your works, your labor, and your endurance, and that you cannot tolerate the wicked. You have tested those who call themselves apostles, but are not, and discovered that they are impostors. Moreover, you have endurance and have suffered for my name, and you have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have lost the love you had at first. Realize how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Verbum Domini. Those who are victorious, I will feed from the tree of life. Blessed the man who follows not the counsel of the wicked, nor walks in the way of sinners, nor sits in the company of the insolent, but delights in the law of the Lord and meditates on his law day and night.
Those who are victorious, I will feed from the tree of life.
He is like a tree planted near running water that yields its fruit in due season, and whose leaves never fade. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked, not so. They are like chaff which the wind drives away. For the Lord watches over the way of the just, but the way of the wicked vanishes.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et tu spiritu tuo.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Lucam.
Gloria tibi, Domine.
As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. And hearing a crowd going by, he inquired what was happening. They told him, "Jesus of Nazareth is passing by." He shouted, "Jesus, Son of David, have pity on me." The people walking in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he kept calling out all the more, "Son of David, have pity on me." Then Jesus stopped and ordered that he be brought to him. And when he came near, Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" He replied, "Lord, please let me see." Jesus told him, "Have sight. Your faith has saved you." He immediately received his sight and followed him, giving glory to God. When they saw this, all the people gave praise to God.
Verbum Domini.
Today we heard from Psalm 1, those who are victorious, I will feed from the tree of life. What is the tree of life? This vestment, you may notice there's roots at the bottom of this cross, and it's bearing flowers and blossoms. It's giving forth life. And so the cross here is depicted as a tree. In fact, it is the tree of life. That in the book of Genesis, we heard about the tree of life in paradise, but that was a prefigurement of the tree of life, the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, from which all life flows to us. We're beginning now, throughout the end of this liturgical year, to read through the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation, but what is the complete title? We heard it today. The Revelation of Jesus Christ. That's the complete title. In fact, the Bible is completely, insofar as the written word has been given to us, is the revelation of Jesus Christ. And so in the Old Testament, we have the prefigurements like the tree of life in the Garden of Paradise. We have the prophecies, which would then be fulfilled in the New Testament with the events of our Lord, of the early church that we read about. But in the book of Revelation, there's something unique from all of that, and that it is the risen Lord who is speaking to us. We heard in the gospel today of our Lord walking on this earth, healing this blind man. But the book of Revelation of Jesus Christ is the end of the Bible. So the beginning of the Bible begins with a wedding, with a marriage, if you will, between our first parents, Adam and Eve. And it concludes with a wedding, but now it is the wedding of the Lamb who was slain, who died on the cross, so that now we might have life through this life-giving event. And it concludes with the marriage supper of the Lamb. And what takes place at the Mass is entering into that reality, which will be realized in its completion in eternal life. So the entirety of the sacred scriptures is the revelation of Jesus Christ, but it concludes then with this book, where it is the risen Lord who's addressing these early churches, the first of which is Ephesus, which was the mother church of that area. It was a metropolitan area. It was a crossroads, if you will, between Jerusalem and Rome. In the middle was Ephesus. And the Lord praises the fact that they have endured much and they continue to persevere. But he wants their love to be what it was at first. You see, we can follow the rules. We can do what we ought to do. But the Lord, most of all, wants a burning love in us. And so it concluded today, you have lost the love you had at first. How do we maintain that? How do we maintain that love and grow? Let it not only just be maintained, but actually intensify. And the way that we do that is by staying close to the fire, the source, the fire of love. And we do that by receiving communion often, or making, as many of you do, spiritual communions. Padre Pio would say to place your heart in the tabernacle when you can't receive communion or you're far from the chapel. So receiving as often as we can the sacraments, the Holy Eucharist, meditating on his word, letting the Lord speak to us. So did you hear the Lord say to you today, what do you want me to do for you? What is it that you want him to do for you today? Lord, I want to see. But you see that this man not only had his physical sight restored as it was, but something deeper and more lasting, his spiritual sight. It is your faith that has saved you, Jesus says to this man. And what does he do? Immediately upon receiving his sight, he follows him. He doesn't go off to go to other things or to even to tell others about what had happened to him. He follows him. He immediately gets up from where he was and he follows him. And not only that, he gives glory to God. That's an example for us to live by faith, following the Lord. And we heard in the Alleluia verse, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life, not just physical sight, but the light of life to guide us to the fullness of life, to the eternal light in heaven. And so as we are coming to the end of the liturgical year, we think of the last things: death, judgment, heaven, or hell. And one of the things that we want to have, to pray for, is for a happy death, a holy death. That's the conclusion of our life. The book of Revelation is a conclusion of the Bible. It speaks of the concluding events of the world. But our life, too, will have its conclusion. And how would you like to die? What would you like it to be like? Sometimes when we encounter people in their passage from this life to the next, we say, I want to die like that. I have, as a priest, of course, accompanied many people who were dying, and even those in the moment of their death, like my own father, who died 2 years ago today or yesterday. And I looked through his little prayer book, and he had prayed, obviously, probably every day, because this little prayer was so worn. It was a prayer for a happy death, and he certainly had that. He had everything the church offers before he passed, that transition from this life to the next. And November 13th will be a day I remember, of course, my father's passage. But it's also a day I remember somebody also very special to me and to our EWTN family, to Jennifer Rodriguez, who passed into eternal life yesterday. And so many of you have been asking about her. She's been struggling with cancer the last 3 years, and fighting valiantly with great strength and faith and hope in God. And so yesterday, after she had died, I went to their home, and Robert told me what her last moments were like. And he gave me permission to share that with all of you, those of you who've grown to love her and the family. And so they were praying the Rosary and Divine Mercy Chaplet and Rosary and Divine Mercy Chaplet at the foot of her bed in their home. And Robert said that they read her favorite passage from Faustina's diary, St. Faustina's diary, and that at the end of, they just completed the chaplet, and I'll read that passage. He said they would always read this passage before they prayed the chaplet. It was Jennifer's favorite from the diary. So these were the words of our Lord to St. Faustina. At the hour of their death, I defend as my own glory every soul that will say this chaplet, or when others say it for a dying person. The pardon is the same. When this chaplet is said by the bedside of a dying person, God's anger is placated, unfathomable mercy envelops the soul. In the very depths of my tender mercy are moved for the sake of the sorrowful passion of my son. I told before the story of a man who was just, he ridiculed the Christian faith, and I'd gone to his bedside with his wife dying at St. Vincent's Hospital. He was in a coma. We prayed this chaplet after I spoke to him and encouraged him to turn away, to repent, to return to the Lord, be sorry for his sins, going through the commandments, pray the Divine Mercy Chaplet. And he died that night, and his wife related to me at the funeral that after I left, tears were streaming down his cheeks. When you say this chaplet, or when others say it for a dying person, the pardon is the same. Unfathomable mercy envelops their soul. So what a beautiful promise. Encourage people to pray the chaplet for those who are dying, especially those who maybe have been far away, but even those who lived a virtuous life. But we want that divine mercy. And so Robert related to me how they had read this passage, they had prayed the Divine Mercy Chaplet, and then they repeated, Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, I love you, save souls. They kept repeating that. And then Jennifer, who had been unresponsive for some time, they had the crucifix near her, and she grasped it tightly. And quietly she said, Jesus, Mary, Joseph, I love you. Save souls. And she exhaled her last. That's how I want to die too, with the name of Jesus, Mary, Joseph on my lips, to let my last breath be glorifying God, following Jesus, to have a holy death, to have a happy death. It's not how we begin, it's how we end. And so the Lord said, or rather in the book of Revelation, I will come if you don't repent, I will come to you, remove your lampstand from its place. Unless you repent, the church would be taken away. But it's really a word for all of us, this need for us to turn to the Lord today. Today is the moment of salvation. Now is the day of salvation, to turn to the Lord, to realize the reality of the fact that we are mortals, that there will be a conclusion to our lives, and that we will be judged in accordance with how we have lived. And so today is a day of salvation. Today is the day to not let that love of the Lord wane, to diminish, but to stay close to the fire, to be enlightened by God's word, to receive him often as we can in the Holy Eucharist, to be men and women of rich in charity. And if we're doing all of those things, then when we come to the end of our days, it is going to be a gentle transition. It will be a happy death, a holy death. Is there such thing as a happy death? Yes. Yes. St. Faustina had a vision of hell, purgatory, and heaven. And she said of those who had gone through so many sufferings in this life, so many trials, that when they entered into glory, what she saw is that in an instant, they completely forgot all of the sufferings that had preceded in their time on earth. They instantly forgot it. St. Paul speaks of that, doesn't he? That what no eye has seen or ear has heard, that's what God's prepared for. It can't even enter our minds. Whatever we imagine heaven to be like falls far short of the reality. And when Robert told me of Jennifer's favorite passage, I continued to read on that same page. This is number 11 was the one that I read, 8:11 in her diary. And she said, "O merciful Jesus stretched on the cross, be mindful of the hour of our death. O most merciful heart of Jesus, opened with a lance, shelter me at the last moment of my life. O blood and water which gush forth from the heart of Jesus as a font of mercy, unfathomable mercy, for me at the hour of my death. O dying Jesus, hostage of mercy, avert the divine wrath at the hour of my death. This is the tree of life. This is our salvation, the blood of Jesus shed for our salvation, that invigorates us, that gives us life, even in the dying process, that we have this divine life alive in us that carries us into the eternal bosom of God forever." And then finally, the next two paragraphs, St. Faustina said, and she wrote this later, "Today I only received Holy Communion and stayed for a few moments of the Mass. All my strength is in you, O living bread. It would be difficult for me to live through the day if I did not receive Holy Communion." Make a spiritual communion if you can't. "It is my shield. Without you, Jesus, I know not how to live. Jesus, my love, today gave me to understand how much he loves me. And although there is such an enormous gap between us, the creator and the creature, and yet in a way there is something like equality, love fills up the gap. He himself descends to me and makes me capable of communing with him." That's a great gift, the greatest gift. So let us follow the example of those who've died happy, holy deaths. May the Lord give us the grace to grow in that fervor, not lose our first love, but rather that it would intensify by staying close to the fire of his divine love. And so inherit with the holy ones eternal life.